Kind thanks go to Brilliant for sponsoring today's episode. Today, amongst other things, I'll explain to you what the Boca Chica SpaceX crew is able to do in just 3 days and how Starships will be able to land on alien planets.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It. And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. We're closing in on the first 18-kilometer flight of a Starship prototype, and SpaceX, as always, is moving extremely fast. Starship serial number 8's tank section is on the final stretch of being built. Everything now is ready for a fairing stack. But let's start with something else today, because boom, you know? What you're looking at here is the awesome camera feed brought to all of us by Lewis and his team from Lab Padre. I'm pretty sure you're familiar with his live streams, but if you're not, go check out his channel for a 24/7 live feed from Boca Chica, Texas with multiple cameras. It's definitely worth it. So serial number 7.1, the 304 stainless steel test tank, had its final test on September 23rd. After a solid week of torture, it was time to show SpaceX how far it can go. And it went far. How far is unknown, but let me guide you through the events real quick. At 4:51 a.m. in the morning local time, serial number 7.1 was filled up all the way to the top with liquid nitrogen, signaled by the cryogenic liquid leaking out of the two top vents sitting on the forward dome. If you look closely, you can see the liquid spilling out of the vent and running down on the side of the tank. After this, SpaceX workers closed the top vent. The end of serial number 7.1 was inevitable from here on. Almost exactly 7 minutes after the buildup had been initiated, serial number 7.1 was not able to take it anymore and ruptured. The rupture occurred on the forward dome. So the ring segments are at an extremely good state by now, and the weakest part now is the dome. You can see a big surge of liquid nitrogen coming out of the rupture. This is due to the pressure and the nitrogen immediately starting to boil off as temperature rises and pressure falls. This can be seen even better if we look at the thermal vision provided by Lab Padre's stream. Bright blue indicates extremely low temperature and the surge of nitrogen immediately spreads out, covering everything in its path. Here are some pictures taken by Mary from NASA spaceflight. In daylight, on the day after the test, the result could be seen in all its detail. We can see that most likely the dome weld that attaches it to the ring section ruptured first. Parts of the dome got pushed up faster than others, causing multiple tears and weld failures on the dome itself. The steel itself got torn apart with very clean looking cracks. This is likely due to the steel being extremely cold while the rupture occurred. As of recording the episode, Musk has not tweeted anything about the test results, and it might very well be that we won't get any information. So it's hard to tell how high the test tank was able to go. If the test was not to SpaceX's satisfaction though, we should see yet another test tank being built in the near future. Just a normal day in Boca Chica, you know? Next up, let's look at what's happened at the construction site since the last update. At the new high bay, intended to be the new building for super heavy stacking, progress is fast as always. The roof is being put in place. In fact, its girder structure is halfway done already. Overall, the building is around 80% finished by now. The reason for it being called a high bay is very clear. It's hard to imagine that a super heavy booster will barely fit in with a few meters to spare to the top. Let me give you the next big news real quick. And big fits it pretty well in this case. What you're looking at here is the first evidence of something gigantic. Let me introduce you to Super Heavy's serial number 1. Where on the last episode I speculated that SpaceX most likely is already working on first segments for their first try at super heavy prototypes, 3 days later I can give you the first pictures. It's finally here. The label states it without any doubt. Com Barrel SE Booster. That's short for Common Dome Barrel for Super Heavy Booster. The common dome, of course, is the dome in the middle between the methane and oxygen tanks, and the barrel is the part that surrounds it. Brandon Lewis was quick to make a first assembly diagram, and it shows where this common dome barrel will be on the final product. Although I think he's slightly off with the ratio between methane and oxygen tanks, and the common dome should be 2 or 3 ring segments further down, it is a fantastic depiction of an even more fantastic piece of hardware. Casper Stanley recently made a very impressive animation showing the enormous scale of a fully stacked Super Heavy booster. He had to use a few more bananas for scale to show the size, and it is a mind-boggling sight. 72 meters. That makes it 2 meters taller than a Falcon 9 booster, including second stage and a Crew Dragon on top. We're in business, everyone. It's being built right now, and it's going to be extremely interesting to see it rise in the next few weeks. And we're still not done with the big news for today. Keep one thing in mind. 3 days. Only 3 since the last update. Incredible. On we go with Starship Serial number 8. It's recently been moved out of the midbay, and this gave Mary's camera a perfect opportunity to shoot some detailed pictures of the aerodynamic covers recently installed on the side. And one thing quickly becomes apparent. I wasn't too sure if Serial number 8 had actuators for the aft flaps. And it does. If we peek into the 3 different recesses, they can clearly be seen. Top and dome being the hinges, and the bigger middle one being the actuator. This is fantastic news. Starship Serial number 8 will indeed be the first fully assembled and working Starship prototype ever made in Boca Chica, Texas. And it gets even better. Liked the update so far? Then click the like button, subscribe to the channel, and maybe even consider becoming a patron to give some vital support. Link is in the description. The team is working relentlessly to provide you with updates twice a week, thanks to SpaceX's mind-boggling speed, and with your support it will be much easier in the future. Of course, What About It also has a merch store filled up all the way with goodies for space nerds. See if you find something that fits you. Every sale supports the show. Links in the description. SpaceX workers finally unpacked Starship Serial number 8's aft flaps. This gave way for a clear and up-close view of all the glory. The build quality for an early prototype looks extremely good. All welds are straight, everything is flush and sleek looking. Well done. Whoever helped build these did a great job. The upper hinge up close, it's a joy to look at it. To finish it off, here's another view of the actuator attachment point. SpaceX has put some thought into how energy and tension will be distributed throughout the flaps. The diagonal lines likely are a sign for internal bracing leading away from the attachment point in a 45 degree angle. This helps the structure to cope with the extreme forces inflicted on such a large flap, while a 150-ton Starship and high wind forces are pulling on it, skydiving down towards the pad again. I'm getting goosebumps just thinking about it. And if you thought this must be it for today's episode and that SpaceX can't possibly have made more progress since the last one, think again. It's SpaceX we're talking about here. What do you do with the present after unwrapping it? Right, you immediately try it out. How does that look? Carlos Nunez from I Can Imagine and For Space Intelligence did one of his artistic approaches again and beautifully framed this shot of Starship Serial number 8 with its attached flaps. He, by the way, is the one guy to go to if you are not looking for detail shots. His pictures, in my opinion, are the most beautiful ones taken at the Boca Chica spaceport. Well done, Carlos, you rock. Looking at it through Mary's lens shows the technical aspects. My verdict, good job, Team Boca Chica. This looks like a very clean installation. Everything fits properly. Everything is in the right place, and it very much looks like a test-worthy candidate. This must be it though, right? There can't possibly be any more progress in Boca Chica in just 3 days. Well, guess again. This is yet another view from La Padre's live cams. And it clearly shows that the SpaceX crew already gave the flaps a test run. Something Mark 1 never did. The flaps moved. It's unknown if it was powered movement or if they were just moved by hand, but they moved nonetheless. After the flaps had been moved into a forward position, workers moved the prototype away from the midbay on a roll lift, most likely to be able to have more room for nose cone stacking and final assembly. This most likely is going to be a standard procedure before every Starship launch in the future. In the same way that a plane tests all the rudders and flaps before takeoff, Starships most likely will flap their wings. Just the thought gives me goosebumps already. And SpaceX is working on what's to come after Starship Serial number 8 again as well. Starship Serial number 11's leg skirt, the lowermost ring segment on a Starship, got finished as well. Again with raised build quality. Every part that moves out of the large construction tents by now looks like it's been designed and produced with a high quality standard in mind. Nomad from the NSF forums was lucky to take a shot of a new nose cone segment. It shows the best view to date of the new forward flap recesses on the nose cones. This might even be the spot for actuators. It's hard to tell though. I could go on with these pictures for a while longer. All progress from the last 3 days. Today I was not able to fit all the progress into one episode again. At least not without properly explaining it, and on my channel you don't just get a picture reel. Starship legs speculation. One thing is still missing on the current generation of Starship prototypes: proper legs suited for daily launches. This is a development step that's most likely very high up on the priority list for the SpaceX Starship engineers right now. To get an idea on what SpaceX might be planning and what the final result might look like in the end, I worked with my 3D artists Eric and Nick again. So let's dive right in. On last Tuesday's episode, amongst other things, I explained to you how the current legs work and what we might expect for the near future prototypes. It was based on a recent tweet by Elon Musk. In that tweet though, he also gave some information on the final leg design currently in development at SpaceX. He said that the V2.0 legs will be wider and taller, like Falcon legs, but at the same time capable of landing on unimproved surfaces and capable of auto-leveling, which the current Falcon 9 legs are not capable of. These are Falcon-style legs. SpaceX has been using them for a while now to do something no other rocket company has been able to do so far. They land orbital rocket boosters on them. Every time, on land and at sea. It's a flip-out design, meaning that at liftoff the legs are attached to the outside of the rocket in an upward-facing position. Just before the touchdown, the legs flip out and downward, lock in place and give the boosters a wide stance for a landing. As they are though, they are not suitable for Starships. They lock in place. It takes a long time to fold them up again to be able to transport the boosters. As they are fixed in place, they are not capable of auto-leveling and they do not have any sort of dampening systems besides crush blocks. Crush blocks can't be reused though, as they permanently deform on a hard impact. So all in all, a working solution for Falcon 9 boosters, but not so much for Starships. So what could Starship's final leg design look like? Let's look at a few possible designs. This is what a Starship could look like with flip-out legs waiting for a launch on the pad. Locked in place in an upward position similar to Falcon 9 booster legs. Eric designed these to look very similar to what SpaceX is already using. They are still missing a heat shield, which would have to be added to the final design, which already poses the first challenge of such a design. Two of the four legs would need heat protection. This means that two of the legs would have a different design. Folding them out and down would look and work very similar to what SpaceX is currently using on Falcon 9 boosters. A dampening system has been added to get rid of the crush blocks, and they have slightly larger feet to give them rough terrain capability. Internal mechanics are protected by a stainless steel casing, so a re-entry does not pose a problem. This would be as close to the current design as possible. Another approach by Nick Henning 3D shows flip-out legs with auto-leveling capability that are flush to the outside when folded up. These legs would make heat shield integration much easier. It's a simple design, capable of multiple reuses before maintenance is needed. A very important aspect when you're on another planet. Finally, Nick also made a version depicting telescope-style legs as seen on current lunar Starship designs. This would be the approach everyone thought SpaceX would go before Elon's tweet mentioning Falcon legs for Starships. The pods are attached to the engine skirt in this case to make the legs fit. The leg does not need to be heat protected. The stance is at least a bit wider. Auto-leveling would be no problem at all. After Elon giving some hints on the current development trajectory though, it's unclear if this is the favorite design. What are your thoughts? Which leg design would you choose? As always, tell me in the comments. Many possible solutions for a common problem. How to make Starships land safely and repeatedly in very different environments. As said in the beginning of this topic, I am very sure that this design chapter is very high up on the internal development list at SpaceX right now. Finding the best solution is extremely important, but it brings a level of uncertainty. Uncertainty that needs to be brought down to the lowest possible level before sending people to Mars. If you want to learn about uncertainty and its underlying principle, today's sponsor is the right address to dive right in. Brilliant is a problem-solving based website and app with a hands-on approach with over 60 interactive courses in math, science, and computer science. Brilliant helps you to achieve your goals in STEM, starting with one small commitment to learning and building up to a long-term challenge and growth. One brand new course on Brilliant tackles the at first very difficult topic of uncertainty. This course gives you mathematical tools for dealing with the flood of information in our lives. For example, can you put a number on how much you don't know? Sure you can. And when you learn something new, how should it change your beliefs about how the world works? Is there some formula for that? Why, yes, there is. This is just one example of all the courses on Brilliant. Brilliant puzzles you, surprises you, and expands your understanding of the modern world. All of Brilliant's courses have storytelling, code writing, interactive challenges, and problems to solve. To learn things the Brilliant way and at the same time support What About It, go to brilliant.org/whataboutit and sign up to try out over 60 interactive courses for free. And if you choose to get the premium subscription, the first 200 people to join through the link will get 20% off the annual premium subscription. Learn new things the Brilliant way. Links in the description. And we're at the Patreon and YouTube member shoutout again. Today's special shout goes to Gary Power, Jane Tizzy, Jim Musselwhite, Lucas McKeon, Ken May, Alan R. Nagel, Samuel Galloway, Eric Amundsen, Terry McEvan, and many others. You rock! If you want to be part of the fast-growing community, get access to our Discord server, chat with the community, the team, and with me in person, head over to my Patreon page or become a YouTube member here. Link is in the description. Thank you so much. The last words, as always, go out to my team, and today's special shout goes out to Framrik for being one of the most active members on the team and in the community. For helping out pretty much everywhere with thoughts, ideas, and knowledge. Thank you for being awesome, Framrik. You rock. Feed from Boca Chica, Texas. Not Boca. Come on. For science. Yes, I am from Germany. Keep one thing in mind. How do you...
Tree.
I look like a dork. On we go with Starships. Right! You. It was fun writing this script, trust me.
For the free.